based on John Ball's novel, In the Heat of the Night, electrified audiences and critics in 1967. And remember this about 1967, in a year that included Mike Nichols' The Graduate, Stanley Kramer's Guess Who's Coming to Dinner, and Arthur Penn's Bonnie and Clyde, In the Heat of the Night, produced by Walter Mirisch, directed by Norman Jewison, won Best Picture. And tonight we are honored to have so much of the creative energy that made In the Heat of the Night possible. So, if you could, please join me in welcoming to the stage a man who, with his brothers, formed, I think, the greatest producing team in Hollywood history. Ladies and gentlemen, Academy Award winner Walter Mirisch.
Sit down.
I walked away too quickly. Sit right there, my friend.
Okay.
All right. Next up, a man nominated for 7 Oscars and the winner of the Irving Thalberg Memorial Award from the Academy, the director of In the Heat of the Night, ladies and gentlemen, Norman Jewison. Okay.
I'm fine.
Norman, how are you? Nice to see you. I'll put you back over here, is that all right?
Over here?
Yeah, over here. I'm going to sit in between you. Just sit there. You're fine there. Okay. All right, where am I? This is good stuff. Up next, nominated for an Academy Award for her first movie, 1952's Detective Story, opposite Kirk Douglas. She has 4 Oscar nominations, 1 win, and typically she turns her relatively small role in the Heat of the Night into a complicated and memorable performance. Ladies and gentlemen, as I said, a hero of mine, please welcome Lee Grant. Hello. Thank you.
Ooh.
And I'm going to sit down now, but I got news for you. We're all about to get back up. Please join me in acknowledging an AFI Lifetime Achievement Award winner, the star of In the Heat of the Night, an Oscar winner for 1963's Lilies of the Field, quite simply one of the finest screen actors of all time. He's sitting back there. Join me in acknowledging Sidney Poitier.
Woo!
They got a camera on him right there.
Oh. Yeah.
Thank you guys for being here. Thank you, Sydney, for coming. Backstage, taking pictures. Quincy Jones was here too. Quincy Jones couldn't stay because he's got to go to the opening of the new movie that he's starring in. Sandy Wexler, it's called. So I just was thinking, you, Sydney was back there, and Lee, and Walter, and Norman, and my God, that is so many valuable years of classic movie experience back there. And all of you seemed delighted and excited to be together. I didn't misread that, did I?
And no, you didn't.
I'm just glad to be alive.
That's what I sensed, Norman. That was my next question. I can strike that now. Norman, glad to be alive. That's a check. Okay. Walter, tell me what led you to this project. What led you to In the Heat of the Night?
Well, I had some years before that met Sydney socially, and we became good friends. We've now been good friends for 70-odd years. I am proud to say that after 70-odd years, we still have lunch together once every week.
Oh, wow.
Woo!
He is my dearest friend, and in the beginning, of course, I thought, you know, I really should try and make a picture with Sydney.
You're no dumb producer. You know what's going on.
And I kept looking for things and talking to agents. And I was very fortunate because Sydney's agent of almost his entire lifetime, Marty Baum, gave me a book called In the Heat of the Night. And I was tremendously impressed, not with the book itself, but with the relationship between the redneck sheriff and this sophisticated big city detective. And I thought, this is what we've been looking for, and I looked around for a writer, and I finally found one who pleased me a great deal, named Robert Allen Arthur. And we worked together on this script and developed a very, very complete treatment of it. He solved in that treatment very many of the things that I thought the book was lacking in.
But he didn't end up writing the screenplay. I love this.
Well, these are the vagaries of movie making.
Yeah.
He calls me up shortly after he gives me this treatment. He says, Walter, he says, I just had a phone call, actually from John Frankenheimer, who's making a picture in the south of France called Grand Prix. He needs a writer very badly. He says, if I take the job, he'll bring my whole family over to the French Riviera for the summer and pay me so much, and they really need me badly. And he said to me, well, what do you think I should do?
Because
I have
this
contract with you. I said, well, you should do what any intelligent man would do. Grab it. And so we lost him. And we replaced him then with Sterling Siliphant, who picked up the cudgels and did a wonderful job. While all this was going on, I'd been consulting Sydney about it, and he read stuff because I wanted him to be a part of the development. And we were now reaching the point where we needed a director.
Yeah, well, you picked the you got the right guy.
Well, I think so too.
Norman, when did you get involved in this? You'd already made The Russians Are Coming. The Russians Are Coming for Walter's company, right?
Yeah.
And you'd made, in addition to a couple of Doris Day pictures, you made Still, I think, flat out, maybe the best gambling movie ever made, best poker movie ever made, The Cincinnati Kid.
Steve McQueen. Absolutely. Yeah.
So what were, in shooting this movie, some of your principal obstacles?
Well, there were two obstacles. One was to complete the screenplay, because the book I didn't think was that good. I mean, with all due respect, Walter, I didn't think the, it was about a Pasadena police detective and so on. And I wanted so many changes, and I worked with Sterling for 6 months. And I told him at the beginning, I said, this is the best screenplay I've seen in years. And then 6 months later, he said, I think it's now the best screenplay. That's the way it all started.
But you both had had an issue, and this was an issue that of a movie that you had decided would be set, as the story was, set in the Deep South with a black police detective from Philadelphia, but it's 1967, and I don't want to speak for him, but you guys have given to understand that Sidney Poitier didn't want to shoot in the South, and you guys agreed that was not a place that you ought to shoot this movie.
Yeah, he said, he said, I don't want to go south of the Mason-Dixon line. And I said, I don't blame you, Sid. But this film is set in Mississippi. So I've got to find a town. And let me see if I can find a place that I think will work. Because, I had a lot of help from my production people. And so we ended up in the southern part of Illinois, way down near the Mississippi River. And
I don't think the Mississippi River is the same as Mississippi, but I hear you.
Well, at least we felt.
Right, sure, I got
you. We felt we were getting to the south.
But the town looked right, correct, Walter?
It was about, I don't know, 30, 45 minutes from St. Louis. And it's called Spartanville, Illinois.
Sparta, right?
We then changed the name of our town in our picture to Spartanville, and all of the signs on the main street were now appropriate.
Let me. So what led you guys to the woman sitting here at the end? Because this is not the forum to do it justice, but Lee Grant was blacklisted for 12 years, basically out of the movie business. An actress to say you had tremendous potential is an understatement. You'd already fulfilled a lot of that potential. And here it was, 1967, and you could have gone in a lot of different directions, but this was a significant role in the reemergence of Lee Grant. Who called you, Lee?
I don't remember. I guess it had to be an agent. But it was a very significant moment for me sitting across the table going up for this part with Norman. I knew, though we never said it until we were in the dressing room back there, I knew that he knew about me. I knew that he knew that I hadn't worked in 12 years and that it was because of the blacklist and that he was giving me the part. There was such a strong connection. It was so emotional for me to see somebody say, yes, you're going to work and you're going to work in a great movie. And that was it. And the way that Sidney and Rod were New York actors, and so I knew them from New York. And when I stepped into Spartanville, Norman and Sidney and Rod were there, to be family, because it was my first venture back into this world.
What was it like? It's a very, very simple question, and I'm afraid to ask it even, but because it seems so unsophisticated, but it's such an obvious question. What was it like to be back and working, and when we started shooting, and your role, and Norman is rolling, and you, there's a one of your, I think your first scene, your first you have a scene with Steiger, and then you have this beautiful, beautiful scene with Sidney in Steiger's office without Steiger in it. If you can, just sort of take me through that. It's in a very emotional scene. It will be for everybody who hasn't seen the picture, and for those who have as well.
I had had a personal experience that I was able to bring to the film, and so before shooting, I stayed away from the set completely. And when we went into it, Norman, I think, had Haskell Wexler handheld on the floor and up and around, and he put Sidney and me together in this small room and really let us improvise. And then shot it. I mean, it was, I was full. He was protective. He was really protective. And so it just emerged as it happened. And that's the great thing about Norman as a director, is that he hands it over to you. He doesn't say, do this, do that. He says, I cast you, therefore, let me see what you, surprise me.
Yeah.
That's the best that a director can say, surprise me.
Walter, let me ask you this, and then Norman, I'll want your response to this too. There, without, first of all, by a clap if you have not seen this movie. Always amazes me that there's anyone in a TCM crowd who hasn't. So we're certainly not gonna spoil the story, but there is a, I think we'd be remiss if we didn't discuss it. There is a there's a slap in right. This movie that is the most famous. You know, Mildred Pierce is the only slap that rivals it, but I think this is the most important slap in Hollywood history.
The slap that was hurled around the world.
That's right. The slap heard around the world. So what? First of all, Walter, you knew that scene was coming. Did that concern you? Did you fear that slap of a black man slapping a white Southerner in a movie might kill distribution in the South, or was the picture already
potential? No, well, that slap probably has more authors than anything else in literature that I know of.
Is the slap in the book?
Huh?
Is there a slap?
No, there's not the slap.
No slap in the book.
My recollection is that the slap was done by Robert Allen Arthur. That was in his draft. We never gave it up. All of us said, you know, that's the heart of the picture, and we will never give this up. I had been making pictures for, well, 9-10 years by that time for United Artists, and we had a very close relationship. I had by that time made Some Like It Hot, The Apartment, West Side Story.
Wow.
Pink Panther.
Pink Panther, The Great Escape. It was very difficult for him to say no. he did say to me, though, you don't want to be responsible for starting riots, do you? And I said, no, we don't want that, I said, but suppose this picture never does play beneath the Mason-Dixon line. And we, you know, there are loads of people in the northern part of this country, New York, Chicago, Detroit, Los Angeles. There are plenty of people there. I said, how much will you give us to make the picture and assume that you never play the picture below the Mason-Dixon line? He said, well, that's an interesting approach. He said, we'll run some figures. And he did. And the next day I went to see him and I said, well, how much are you going to give me to make the picture? He said, I'll give you $2 million. He said, but you've got to give me your word of honor that you will do everything possible to make it for that. I then imposed that on poor Norman.
Let me just interrupt and ask you if a Hollywood producer has ever broken his word of honor.
I can speak only for myself.
Okay, all right.
And my own career.
All right.
I tried always to keep my word of honor. I said to him, I will do everything in my power to bring it in for that. And
you came pretty
and
close.
I did, and I said to Norman, when I gave him the project, I've given my word, this is going to limit you terribly, I know it, but that's part of what we're buying. And he said, let me think it over, and then thank God he ultimately agreed that he would do it. And he damn well did it. I think it cost $2,050,000.
So, Norman, you did not let Sidney Poitier and Larry Gates rehearse that slap, did you? How did that scene develop when they shot it? It'll be amazing when these people see it on the big screen and hear it, which is a big part of it, too. But how did you, you didn't, there was no rehearsing that, right?
No, it was one of those things which had to be instinctual, because Sidney was playing a detective. He was playing a police officer, and you don't slap a police officer.
Yeah.
And nothing happens. And he wasn't even thinking, but when Larry Gates slapped him, he slapped him back so fast, just like that, because he was reacting as a police officer, as he should, and it was poor Rod Steiger who was left there in a state of shock to solve the situation.
Right. What are you going to do?
What are you going to do? Did you see that?
Did you? That's right. Yeah.
I'll do the line reading.
Okay.
And he said,
Did you see that?
Yeah. Did you see that?
I saw it.
What are you gonna do about it?
I don't know.
That's right. That's what it was. And it. And I'm just curious because it got a big laugh in the theaters. It will tonight. And well, it won't now because we just ruined it. But the it would have. Did you, when you're shooting it, do you expect it to get that laugh?
No. I didn't expect. I didn't expect to get any laughs in the picture, and I was just shocked when he says when Steiger looked at Sidney after Sidney's picked up in the police station as a suspect in a murder, because naturally you're gonna pick up the first black person you could find. And he's brought in, and Rod looks at him, and he said, what are you doing? Where'd you get all that money, first of all? Because they searched him, and they put some money down. And he said, well, I earned it in Philadelphia on my way to visit my mother. And he said, well, there are no trains this time of night. And then you hear a train. And then he realizes that Sidney's telling the truth.
Yeah.
And then when he says, where are you from? He said, Philadelphia. He said, Mississippi? He said, no, Pennsylvania.
That's good, man.
And then the remarkable line was, well, what do they call you? What's your name? And he said, Virgil Tibbs. And he said, Virgil. And he laughs at him and tries to put him down. in Sydney, doesn't do anything, very stoic. And then he said, what do they call you up there in little old Pennsylvania? And he said, they call me Mr. Tibbs.
Yeah, that's good. So we only got a couple of more questions.
And that got a laugh.
That got a laugh?
That got a laugh. And I couldn't figure out why it got a laugh.
I want to ask you guys, and it relates to that, because Rod Steiger won the Best Actor Oscar, and no one disputes Steiger's brilliance, and that that Oscar was deserved, no question. But he got to chew gum. He got a lot to do. Look, playing a racist is hard, but it gives you meat from which to, I mean, Lee could explain this better than I am, obviously. But Sidney Poitier had to communicate everything without speaking, much of what he had to do without speaking, with his eyes, with his jaw, with his movements. And to me, as great as Rod Steiger is, the best performance in that movie and the hardest performance in that movie is Sidney Poitier's, and that's the best actor in 1967.
Oh, yeah. I agree.
But I'm a cable TV host. I'm curious, first of all, Lee, what do you think of that? Is that a fair assessment?
Well,
that's a no.
No. It's so much more than that. I mean, what you're bringing up is so much more of that. Sidney had within himself such electricity, such power, and he took this movie where no one else could have taken it. I mean, your heart and your mind was with him. He was the right thing,
right,
and the rest were the wrong thing. And nobody could have pulled that off but Sidney.
But Steiger was a method actor.
Yeah.
So I realized that, and I said, you know, I've been looking at television and looking at a lot of Southern sheriffs, and they belly is kind of hanging out over it. I said, I'd like you to put on a little weight. And he says, oh, God, I don't want to put on any weight. I'm an actor. I'll act fast. and then I said, well, you know, they chew cigars down there. They chew tobacco. And he said, I don't want to smoke a cigar all the time. He said, how about if I chew gum? And every time I'm thinking, I'll really start to go. But I'll stop when I have something to say. And so he worked on this, and he worked on chewing that gum, and he made it into a very personal thing, and as only a method actor can do, where they always grab on to something, whether it's a prop, whether it's a thing, they always have something. And I thought he was quite ingenious the way he used it.
So
interesting thing you said a minute ago about the Academy Award that year for Sidney and so forth. You know, it's instructive to remember that in that one year, 1967, Sidney made To Sir With Love, Guess Who's Coming to Dinner, and In the Heat of the Night.
Yeah.
That is the final tribute to the genius of the great actor, Sidney Poitier.
Agreed. And an important thing to remember. Before we go, Quincy Jones, when he was going to be here, was obviously going to talk about the music, and the music in the film is so important, including Ray Charles, you'll hear singing the title song, but also this sort of vaguely, partly Southern, partly jazz, a whole different kind of sound than we were used to in movies, right?
That's right. And it, and well, it had the wonderful lyrics by Alan and Marilyn Bergman.
Well, actually, so Alan and Marilyn Bergman are here.
I think they're here.
They are. So, so, and by the way, I'd like to point out that, that sitting right behind them is an actor who had a breakout performance, who had made his screen, made his screen debut in The Heat of the Night, and then 6 weeks later had his breakout performance in Cold Blood. Scott Wilson is here also, one of my favorite character actors. By the way, you know, Quincy was going to be here, so I did all this research on Quincy. You know, he has 27 Grammys, and I'm not kidding, 80 Grammy nominations? Yeah, I don't have any.
But you know, when the Bergmans wrote the lyrics to that song, In the Heat of the Night, and I said to Quincy, I said, you know, it's such a great blues song. Who can we get to do this? And he said, well, you know, I could call Ray Charles. I said, Ray Charles? You know Ray Charles? And he said, very well. Now, Ray came in, and he says, well, Ray wants to see the picture. I said, he's blind. What are you talking about? He wants to see the picture. He said he wants to see the picture before he'll do the song, because he just wants to make sure that it's going to be something of value. So he sat there, you know. I turned the sound up a little bit. And, you know, he went on, and then he listened. And then I would say, they're just going, you know, I'd whisper something to him. And then all of a sudden, he heard
the slap.
He heard the slap, and he says, he didn't slap. He didn't slap him back. And I said, yeah. He says, maximum green, man. Maximum green. I didn't know. He was so cool, I never knew what he was saying.